Let's go ahead and jump into our next talk. And we have Chris Buchanan with us, who is an audio development engineer at CereProc. And CereProc is a Scottish speech technology company. And he has a talk that's entitled Performance Synthesis Using CereWave. Over to you, Chris.
Hello, everyone. My name is Chris Buchanan, and I'm the audio development engineer at CereProc. Thank you very much for taking the time to be here virtually to listen to me talk about something we've been working hard at over the last couple of years, I guess. Thank you very much to Josh and Timur for putting this together and letting me speak. That's very much appreciated. So yeah, my main aim for this talk is just to get you folks to think about the performance synthesis challenges and possibilities and potential applications. And to think of and ask lots and lots of questions that none of us here in the topic or in the industry at large have even thought of yet. So I should probably start with a brief introduction for the company that I work for. We are called CereProc. We are a Scottish speech technology company based in the capital city of Scotland, Edinburgh. We're a small team. And there's only four of us usually in the office. Well, not in the office at the moment, at any one time. But collectively, we've extensive experience across many facets of speech technology and machine learning for audio and computational linguistics and audio DSP engineering. Our research is regularly up against the giants of Google and Amazon and Apple and Microsoft. And our development focuses on thoughtful deployment of our voices across as many platforms and devices as possible. Our main sort of flagship product is called CereVoice, and it's used in all sorts of industries, sectors, and applications, most notably robot technology and robotics, more recently in games and PS4 and Xbox mainly. AAC devices for people who need assistance with communication for whatever reason. In airports and railway stations for tannoy systems, and things like libraries and audio-assisted reading devices and things like that, and all sorts of virtual assistants and call center technology. We've loads of languages and dialects. We've obviously, with being an English company, we specialize in English voices across lots of dialects and accents. And yeah, we find our place in the world as a typical TTS, text-to-speech company. We focused on the provision of characterful, engaging, emotional, and expressive voices that cover a huge number of these languages and dialects. In particular, over the last couple of years, we've been involved in some really interesting and thought-provoking projects encompassing voice cloning, identity revival, and things like that. But a recurring theme with some of these more recent projects seems to be that despite the sometimes maybe high profile or slightly controversial nature of the project, nobody seems to know who we are. This is certainly not intentional, but probably important to maintain an ethically transparent mindset when working with sometimes quite sensitive and emotionally provocative material. One of the more recent and maybe interesting examples of voice cloning and voice revival that we worked on recently was one for a company called Rothko. So the idea was, and I'll play this video, it was to recreate an authentic voice for JFK to deliver the speech that he was supposed to deliver on that fateful day in Dallas in 1963. So we, over the duration of 8 weeks, analysed loads of speeches and put his voice back together.
In a world of complex and continuing problems, in a world full of frustrations and irritations, America's leadership must be guided by the lights of learning and reason, or else those who confuse rhetoric with reality and the plausible with the possible will gain the popular ascendance with their seemingly swift and simple solutions to every world problem.
So it gives you an idea of what the final voice sounded like. at the time, this was quite a while ago, three years ago. The techniques that we were using were a blend of traditional unit selection speech techniques and deep neural networks. At the time, it was a huge advancement in TTS, and we were the first in in doing it this way with AI assisted audio speech made completely out of speech data, often not the best quality speech data, as you might expect. It came from the 60s, so lots of different recording devices and equipment were used. So it was a fun, challenging project, and it certainly sparked a lot of interest, a lot of thought propagation and things like that. So what I'm actually talking to you today, though, is performance synthesis. And the main bulk of this at the moment is singing. And it's what we've been working on quite hard over the last 2 years. So what better way to continue it than with a glimpse at the first computer ever to sing? So in 1961, the IBM 7094 was this very computer. The vocals were programmed by John Kelly and Carol Lockbaum, and the accompaniment was programmed by Max Matthews. So here's a little clip. So in order to talk about the technology behind singing synthesizers, we need to acknowledge the fact that it's always kind of been hanging off the coattails of speech synthesis and traditional TTS. Both use the same systems and sets of assumptions. We'll delve into this in a little bit more detail. We're talking about these kind of technologies. There's three main flavors, at least from our standpoint. There's the traditional unit selection, which has been around for a long time, and it's typically what you would hear when you think of TTS, when you think of personal assistants and computer devices talking to you. This is a concatenative approach, and I'll explain what this means in a little bit more detail. But there's also two other kind of main flavors of TTS these days. There's one which would be a feature generation based deep neural network approach, where we enlist the logic and the mature technology of a vocoder, and we get a model to statistically parameterize this vocoder and be able to input and output speech features. But also in the very cutting edge of things, we've got what is known as neural waveform synthesis. If you have heard of the likes of WaveNet or MelNet or WaveRNN or any waveform time domain based audio synthesis, this is what CereWave is kind of inspired from. It's what's come out. It's our kind of flavor of that kind of technology. And you'll hear a few demos of that at the very end. But let's go through the unit selection synthesis type approach first, because it's quite relevant when we think of things like Vocaloid, which some of you may have heard of. So the idea behind this system is that we chop up a huge corpus of recorded speech into its smallest fully formed pieces. These are usually called phonemes or diphones, basically a fully formed unit of speech. We cluster these and then build a relatable database that can construct any piece of speech. An example of unit selection singing synthesis is Vocaloid. This is one of the most popular commercially available singing synthesizers. It needs to incorporate a huge database, and that needs to include all possible combinations of phonemes of the target language, so usually English, although it was developed mainly in Japan first, so there's lots of Japanese voices as well. But in the English case, this would mean that you need all possible combinations of consonant to vowel, vowel to consonant, and vowel to vowel, all of these diphones essentially, and we need these at all possible pitches in the voice's feasible range. We need to cover all of these different aspects, cover all those bases, make sure they're properly processed and put into this database or library. So I think I've got a sample of what this voice would sound like.
Daisy, Daisy, give me your answer, do I'm half crazy, you're for the love of you. It won't be a stylish marriage. I can't afford a carriage, but you look sweet on the seat of a bicycle built for you.
All right, so that was Vocaloid. On the other side of the coin, we've got what is called parametric synthesis. And this has only really become popular over the last 10 years or so with the arrival of cheap GPUs and the software toolkits to harness their true potential. So deep neural networks became very popular in the speech synthesis world as a way of predicting vocoder features. Once your generative deep learning architecture was tried and tested to generate these features, the performance and the quality of speech synthesis soon caught up with older, more traditional unit selection systems. And this very quickly became the preferable choice for a lot of industry users and customers. So for speech, this was kind of a nice step-by-step process, and the uplift was soon apparent with each step. But with singing, it wasn't quite as straightforward. For some, the uplift in quality just wasn't there. If it was, it was quite unstable and sensitive to perturbations in the training of the voice, the model, and the databases and the architecture and other things that were involved in building a voice. And at that point, it was very much a hacked together system where, because of the nature of parametric synthesis systems, we have a lot more control over the actual vocal system as a source filter type approach. So we were able to basically tell the model, produce these phonemes at these durations and at these pitches, much like a music score would dictate to the singer what they're supposed to be doing at any given time. But as we might guess, it's not always that simple. If you want singing to become more dynamic and natural, then you have to throw some more magic dust in there. So despite the shortcomings, maybe, the proof of concept soon gathered some attention and interest, and a customer that we worked on or worked with in the past called Hanson Robotics. So this is Sophia. She's been on a fascinating journey. We're quite proud that she's speaking with a voice that we built specifically for her. The CEO of Hanson Robotics is a guy called David Hanson. He's a man of wild imagination and vision. And after the completion of his first project, it wasn't long before David's imagination went a little wilder. The Singing Sophia project was triggered after a pondering email from him asking how difficult it would be for CereProc to get their flagship Sophia robot to sing. At that stage, we only had a toy kind of proof of concept to go on, but we thought, I mean, how hard could it be, really? During the course of the project, we came up against various interesting obstacles, and it wasn't long before we found ourselves in uncharted territory. The kinds of questions that came up during the project are ones I'm hoping I'll get some of you thinking about today. But here is hopefully a clip of kind of a summary of the project with Sophia.
Remember Sophia's duet with Jimmy Fallon?
Say something, I'm giving up on you.
She makes singing look easy. However, it was no small feat. First, the woman who made the original recordings for Sophia's voice recorded the song at a recording studio. Next, we then trained a neural network model on the structure of the recorded passages. The neural net was then able to produce a sequence of musical notes and even vocal phonemes, which form the sounds necessary to create human speech. To add an extra layer of richness, we created a cool vibrato effect by modulating the pitch and volume of Sophia's voice. Now Sophia can sing anything if she has the words and frequency values. What song should we teach Sophia to sing next?
So yeah, they do a pretty good job of dramatizing what is essentially just one or two of us just sitting at a keyboard, swearing at a terminal at why something isn't training, or things are crashing as they usually do. But this brings us on to sort of a more thought-provoking aspect of things, in that when we think about the differences between speech and singing, what are we actually talking about? Like, how detailed and quantitative can we be with these differences? So this is a topic of interest to us for various reasons, and we got a master's student from the University of Edinburgh to deal with these questions in pretty good detail. This formed the bulk of their final project, and they observed that the most significant difference between speech and singing is perhaps the most obvious. It's the presence of rhythm, constraining to some extent the otherwise free nature of phoneme or syllable duration. So usually this musical feature encourages singing to behave more pseudo-periodically than ordinary speaking. Most songs are organized with repeated segments from bar to chorus level. These repeated segments usually have similar rhythms and prosody, which lead to similar phone length distribution and pitch contour in similar segments. So we compare this kind of layered hierarchical rhythm and pattern recognition with speech. Speech does not usually have this repeated structure in everyday conversation. So the plots on the screen vaguely try to capture what this means in a more numerical sense, where we have the presence of rhythm coming out as kind of periodic fluctuations in audio signals that can be captured and analysed to some extent. And then on the right-hand side of the screen, we can talk about the dynamics differences between speech and singing. So that we're talking about breath mainly. Singers need usually a strong air stream to generate a relatively louder voice, to hold a note and to support continuous pronunciation of long words or sentences to adhere to the rhythm. So the plots on the right-hand side of the screen try to illustrate this by showing that the breath, basically in between two similar phrases, one spoken and one sung, the breath is a lot stronger, it's a lot louder, it's more pronounced, basically. Yeah, I mean, the features specific to singing, at least ones that we brush on here, alongside those common in speech, they exhibit various spectral and temporal characteristics, which can be modelled accurately enough to reproduce. That's not an issue. We can do that. The challenge really is to be able to do this modelling with portability and robustness in mind when a specific environment is taken away. So we're talking about ideas of real-time aspects. If we could get something to perform, to sing alongside a human musician, for example, are we able to capture and synthesize singing and noise? You know, all these kind of things we could start thinking about in a more general sense of performance synthesis. So this would probably be a good time to take a slight detour and go outside the realm of singing into a more general performance aspect. So at this point, I'm going to dive out of the presentation and take you through a very quick demo of our vocal puppetry application. So the kind of applications for this would be in any kind of performance setting, really, where a person would want to morph, transform, or basically perform a TTS system. Because it's in such a pre-alpha stage, we're currently looking at a text document that says vocal puppetry on it. That's not very informative. What I'm going to do is I'm going to show you what happens when we speak into it with a live mic, with the mic that I'm using to speak to you. So I'm going to load up the system, and I've equipped it with a voice called William. William is a English middle-aged male. He's got quite a posh accent, you could say. And if left to his own devices, he kind of maybe sounds a bit grumpy. And the other inputs tend to be more technical. They tend to be more to do with the system itself. Of the various gubbins that are involved with the system, we need to be able to perform forced alignment. And that basically means for any audio that we give it, it needs to be able to spit back segmentation of words and phonemes and syllables and things like that, which CereVoice then needs to produce natural output. So in this case, we're using an aligner from Montreal. It's from the McGill University. It's called Montreal Forced Aligner. And that in turn is equipped with a English dictionary and an English model, which uses to acoustically align audio with linguistic features. So that's all I've done there. So let's
give this a go. We're going to start up the application. What it's going to do is it's going to load CereVoice. It's going to load the voice that I've asked it to load. And it's then going to wait for me to start recording. So let's just do this right now. Hello, my name is Chris. It's then going to take that audio and push it through a few different processes, namely automatic speech recognition, first of all. And it's going to check that it picked up my initial words correctly. So it thinks I said, hello, my name is Chris, which I did. So that's fine. Let's continue. It's then going to put the audio through the forced alignment that I mentioned. It's also going to put it through a pitch tracker to pick up any frequency information it needs. And then it's going to shove all that information into CereVoice and produce an output. So I'll keep quiet.
Hello, my name is Chris.
All right, so that was pretty close, but you can hear a few artifacts at the start, both with my particular voice, having a Northern Irish lilt to it, and the fact that I don't have any decent microphones with me in the current lockdown location that I am. I'm going to use a pre-recorded prompt from my boss, taken in more ideal circumstances in our vocal booth in the office. I think it was recorded last year. I'll let you listen to what the input is.
He seems such a nice guy.
So hopefully you heard that. He said he seems such a nice guy. Don't know who he's talking about. So we feed that into the Vocal Puppetry app. It's equipped with CereVoice Sarah. She's another English, Southern English female, and English dictionary and English aligning model. And when we put it through the Vocal Puppetry app, it's not listening for the microphone input anymore. It's already got what it needs. The ASR thinks it says, he seems such a nice guy, so that's good. Goes through the same kind of procedure, so let's have a listen to see what it comes out with.
He seems such a nice guy.
Cool, so that sounded okay. Alright, so as well as speech input, you can perform anything vocally, really, and it will try its best to replicate and reproduce in a different voice. So the obvious next step would be singing. And for this, I will use a pre-recorded prompt because I'm not going to sing. I don't sing. And I've used one from here. I'll let you listen to it first of all.
Dream a little dream of me.
All right, hopefully you heard that. We're going to feed that into the Vocal Puppetry app. In this case, we've equipped it with CereVoice Andy, who's an American male, American boy male. Sounds a little bit like Bart Simpson. And let's see how it deals with this one.
Dream a little dream of me.
So that gives you a very vague, brief idea of what it is when we say vocal puppetry. And yeah, I think that's probably as much as I can say and show you at this stage, but it's very much a work in progress. Hopefully this is a bit more enlightening than me just trying to vaguely describe what it is we're working on. So back to the presentation.
And something I'll go into touch on very briefly now is another aspect of performance synthesis. So we called it the Star Spangled Noodling Study. And the idea behind it is, we analysed 10 performances of the Star Spangled Banner taken from the Super Bowl of various years by 10 female artists. And we put through a series of processes to basically analyse the amount of ornamentation they applied to their performance. We were able to say for each singer how much they noodled or deviated from the target score. So the things we're talking about are performances like these.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what summer only we had at the twilight's last gleaming.
Whose broad stripes and bright stars
through the perilous fight. Oh, the realm once we watched with so good
and least great. So that's the selection of artists that we're talking about, basically. And the results of this very scientific and serious star-spangled noodling study were as follows. The artist that warbled, noodled, deviated the most was Mariah Carey, and the individual who stuck to the traditional score the most was Whitney Houston in this case, although we only sampled 10 performances. So if you think about it a little bit, this does make sense. Our metric did react to deviation in a kind of expected musical way. But one thing that may or may not be completely fair is that the idea of a performer switching octaves, maybe switching two octaves, results in a massive deviation, a massive fluctuation in the noodling quotient, which for Mariah Carey makes sense because she does tend to flick up two octaves to the range of canines and out of the range of human hearing. And this understandably sent the metric berserk. So the purpose of this, I did struggle to grasp sometimes whilst I was working on it, but the PR company were fairly adamant that this would be, and it was made into like a thought-provoking general interest article, which maybe got people thinking more about what it means to be a good singer, what it means to be a desirable singer, what human-like qualities do we look out for when we listen to a nice voice, as well as analysing and providing data analysis for these kind of performances in a more musical way. We can go forward into the synthesis stage as well and take out someone's voice completely and stick in another voice. So this is an example of that.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, multiple Grammy Award winner and Houston native, Beyoncé Knowles.
Oh, say can you see
by the dawn's early light
what so proudly we hailed
at the twilight's last gleaming,
whose broad stripes and
for the ramparts we watch were so gallantly sleeping, and the rockets trembling,
the bombs bursting in escape room.
So yeah, I'll leave it to your imagination to try and figure out who we replaced Beyoncé's voice with, but we know it's synthesized, we know it isn't real because he remembered all the words to it. So something else I want to quickly touch on is something that will be particularly relevant, I think, for the audience here, is the idea of the user interface that we will connect to these kind of performance tools and performance synthesis ideas. And it's something I'm currently working on, at least for the vocal puppetry application, is a kind of easy to use and intuitive user interface. But here are some examples of various attempts at a musical interface for these kind of things. So it's not altogether straightforward. There's a lot of different ways of approaching it. No one way is better than the other, and nobody has the right answer, I feel. For instance, on the top left, we've got the music XML specification, and that would be maybe the most common way of a computer interacting with a musical score. There's a straightforward conversion between the XML text and a score that you typically see in Sibelius or Finale or something. Vocal synth from Isotope is an incredible tool, which kind of sits in this space because it uses a lot of vocoder technology and a lot of voice processing and synthesis ideas, and it goes for a more traditional plug-in interface with lots of dials and knobs and sliders. On the top right, we've got Vocaloid, at least Vocaloid version 5, and it tries to go for a hybrid traditional MIDI piano roll interface alongside integrated lyrics and some pitch contours as well to try and capture everything that a voice can do within one interface. It's not easy. This stuff isn't easy at all. If there's one thing to take away from me being here, talking to you, is that we would love to have ideas and collaboration and thoughts on this particular aspect of performance synthesis as a interactive tool, as a plugin, as a standalone app, as something that people can play with, but also use to compose with and generally augment maybe their expressive palette, so to speak, and also to think about who's individuals, maybe they've lost their voice or are losing it, but they want to keep ways of expressing themselves that may not fall under the traditional TTS scope. So that's kind of all I wanted to say about that. To finish off with, then, I wanted to talk a little bit about latest and greatest shiny new flagship system, a system that incorporates what's known as neural waveform-based deep learning technology. We can give people high-quality synthetic voices with a strong natural resemblance to the original speaker. It allows us to build custom voices more cost-effectively and efficiently than ever before. For a typical unit selection system with the full selection of genres, like angry and happy and newsreader style and all the type of genres that you may want to use within a TTS voice, we typically needed about 6 hours of audio, and that was kind of a common requirement across the board. With this new system, we can do it with as little as 30 seconds of audio. So alongside this, the full control over the voice itself with its the parametric structure of it means that we can get any voice to speak, sing, and perform any language in any gender, in any accent or age. Those all effectively become parametric sliders within each voice. So this in turn allows us to build hundreds of voices very quickly. And on top of that, we can build hundreds more using this voice pooling and adaptive methodology. So this is all currently available. It's available from our website as a cloud service, as a cloud API. But something that a milestone that we've hit very recently is it's also available as a standalone, locally installed application. This basically means on your phone, you can run deeply recursive neural net speech waveform inference or synthesis in real time. That's on mobile, that's on Apple, and on recent Android phones as well. So that was kind of a milestone we hit pretty recently. And it's something I believe not many others can do. So to finish things off then, I wanted to show you what CereWave could sound like for a few different voices that we currently offer. When we direct it towards a song that you may have heard previously already.
Daisy, Daisy, give me your oxygen. I'm half crazy, all for the love of you.
It won't be a stylish marriage.
You look sweet upon the seat of a bicycle made for two. Daisy, Daisy, give me your answer too.
I'm half crazy, all for the love of you.
It won't be a stylish marriage. I can't afford a carriage, but you look sweet upon the seat of a bicycle made for two.
Daisy, Daisy, give me your yarns and two. I'm half crazy, over the world of you.
It won't be a stylish marriage. I can't afford a carriage,
that you look sweet upon the seat of a bicycle made for two.
Thank you very much for listening. Bye-bye.
Wow. Give it up for Chris. This was incredible. I'm just going to actually remove these so you don't hear my double voice. Okay, so we should be fine now again. Wow. That was really something, Chris. And unfortunately, we had a little bit of a technical difficulty in the middle of it, so our actual presenters couldn't hear the presentation along with us, which is a shame. But yeah, wow, unbelievable. Just going to close this out. And we have quite a few questions. Are you with us, Chris? Can you hear me?
Yes, yeah, I can hear you fine.
Okay, yeah, thank you so much for your time with this. And it is really unbelievable what you've done here with CereProc and CereWave. And we have a couple questions here. Some of them I don't really understand, so I hope you understand them. So Brady asks, how do you approach phonemes that can both be voiced or unvoiced, e.g. ZH or TH?
Yeah, so I think he or she is alluding to the idea of trying to deal with maybe transitions and synthesis of voiced and unvoiced phonemes, especially in singing. And it's a really good question, and it's really relevant for speech and singing synthesis, because you kind of need a good system to be able to equally deal with both in very different ways, seamlessly. And it's the seamless bit is the really tricky bit. But specifically with singing, thankfully, the unvoiced portions of speech or singing, they don't have an associated frequency, usually, if we're talking about purely unvoiced portions. So that we can effectively ignore. And it becomes more a kind of constrained noise kind of synthesis, especially in terms of maybe synthesizing a hissing SH kind of sound, things like that. So yeah, depending on the application, for singing, it's not as much of an issue, because people don't tend to notice artifacts in unvoiced portions. So if we concentrate on the melodic rhythmic parts, and that's usually to do with the voiced portions, then we can get away with a little bit more in the unvoiced bits. Hopefully that answers the question.
Great. So there's a question from Russell. Is the GPU processing from CUDA, does it run real time, or is this for training?
So the training of the voice models is very much quite an intensive process, especially with the most recent CereWave system that we have. So that would be akin to like a WaveNet style highly recursive training type system. And we've got kind of just basically a local farm to deal with that, various GPUs being used there. But the inference, the synthesis, the prediction, that's all real time. That's we passed that milestone recently with most sort of desktop and laptop OSs, as well as mobile, where we're able to do that in real time. And that was tricky. It needed a lot of really deep, down low-level engineering, but we're just about managing it.
Amazing. And we have a question from Peter about unit selection approach. Can you please elaborate more on the techniques used to smooth the transitions between units?
Oh, yeah, that's a classic issue, and I don't think anybody's fully solved that yet. So there's a thing called join errors and join costs that are really closely associated with the quality and performance of a unit selection system. And it's essentially, we're really sensitive to these artifacts that you get when you just ram these two units together. It can be something as horrible as a transient or a burst of noise, but it can be something really more subtle as well, that even in speech, because our ears are so sensitive to it, it needs to be so, so good. So to deal with that, there's various different techniques. Some are a lot more clever than others, but generally the more clever it is, the more CPU it takes up. The simplest would be a simple crossfade, where you just use gain crossfading in a kind of maybe linear or a sinusoidal way to try and mask the artifact as much as possible. But you can go for like autocorrelation and cross-correlation approaches as well, where you try and use a spectral approach to meld the two phonemes together. But that's where like diphone synthesis and triphone synthesis comes into play, because if we can try and get these units in context, that we may not need to have to do as many joins either, and that kind of reduces the problem as well. Yeah, so that helps.
Great. And there's another question that's kind of similar to one of the previous questions about how are the final singing and TTS models optimized in terms of real-time performance? Do they require GPU or do they just run on the CPU?
They run on a CPU. I think that's always going to be an intention. Something we've always tried to do is get these things working on as many devices as possible. And even though Apple are making headway as to put like actual dedicated units in their phones for you know, parallel inference and things like that, we want things to run on older devices and most devices. So it's CPU inference only. That's real time. And the actual optimization occurs. We started from a few different sort of well-known toolkits and frameworks, namely MXNet and TensorFlow. And then we kind of went our own direction from there. We did a lot of porting and optimization at a low level to get these things running as best as possible. And because we had that kind of combined knowledge of the software engineering, but also the actual speech synthesis side of things, we knew exactly what we wanted to optimize for in terms of the audio that needed to come out, if that makes sense.
That's great. So we have a question from Florian. Is the goal to make an alternative plugin to Vocaloid that sounds more natural, or is it to automatically make it sing along with humans live? And are there any plans to develop a plugin that utilizes this technology?
Certainly the goal is not to go against the likes of Vocaloid. Vocaloid has done incredibly well to make this even any much of a reality at all. The various kind of examples of user interfaces as well that I've put up, it was a kind of way of demonstrating how hard the problem is. Like when we talk about interacting with this kind of instrument in a way that's intuitive, it's such a difficult problem. And all of those attempts, they do such a good job of solving that problem. We couldn't even begin to try and scratch the surface of that. What we're basically looking for is for someone who's matured in that kind of technology to work with us, because the back end is there. It's ready to go. It's the front end that needs further work and development. And even then, it wouldn't sit in the same space as Vocaloid. They've got a very mature kind of space, especially in Japan and Southeast Asia. Mm. It's more a thought-provoking thing. It's a good question, because what would we want to do with it? And there's all sorts of improvisation and AI musician applications for this, as well as the more typical post and music production scenarios. But we wouldn't shoebox ourselves like that really at this stage.
Great. And we got one more question from Architect. How does CereWave deal with the high training cost of deep learning models?
The high training cost with lots of data and lots of GPUs, I guess, is probably the simple answer for that. We're lucky in that because we've come from a TTS background and we're moving into this machine learning space. We've got a lot of data already, both available to us and through open sources as well. So there's lots of data for anyone to use to be able to train these models. It was a kind of a smart investment early on to get this kind of these servers up and running locally to us, so we wouldn't have to rely on bigger entities with bigger farms elsewhere, I guess. Yeah.
Great. And we have one more question from Ardon. Maybe a bit of a generalized question. What would you build the front end in? What would you use to build the front end?
Well, it would attract and make sense to a lot of people already working in the same kind of environment. Juice would be the obvious first choice to get it. And that kind of would retain maybe a lot of the cross-platform and cross-device deployment that we would want to have. Juice obviously has that going for it for sure. Our main sort of offering, the SDK and the cloud service itself, they all run in various different popular languages like C, C++, Java, and Python, you know, APIs. Mm-hmm. So it's always been a case of serving to maybe a middle customer who would then work on the front end more and put it out there themselves.
Uh-huh. Great. And just to go back to the cost of training, the person asking clarified, and he was asking about the financial cost.
That's a good question. We've laughed about this in the past because we're in a sort of a communal building for different companies, and I reckon our electricity cost is pretty sky high because of these servers, but they're charging us the same as everyone else. So it's about the same as not having their servers there at all. If that's any clarification.
Great. Okay. So looks like we've answered all the questions. Thank you very much once again, Chris, for your time.
Thank you very much for having me. Thank you, Josh. Cheers.
And